Maribel and Jorge, because your work and efforts address the larger societal issues that Latino youth and families are up against. So I'll have, as I mentioned, folks talk a little bit about their work, and then we'll segue into questions. But Maribel, can you share with us what your respective organization is doing, particularly as we look at the whole community of Latinos and the importance of addressing larger behavioral and societal health risks for Latino families?
Good morning, buenos dias, everybody. I'm so pleased to be here. Thank you so much for having me. And as Gabby said, I work at the Colorado Health Foundation, which is a state-based foundation, actually the third largest health foundation in the country, but we only focus and make investments in the state of Colorado. So before getting in full into the question, I want to just tell you a little bit about what we believe at the Colorado Health Foundation, because I think it's important in guiding our work, and what I will tell you in a little bit more detail in a minute. So at the Colorado Health Foundation, we believe that health is a basic human right. We also know that not everybody has the same opportunities to be healthy, to live their healthiest lives, because of the conditions in which they live and are often born into. And we know that this is particularly true for many Latino children and youth in Colorado and in the U.S. in general. We also know that there are countless drivers of health that go beyond just access to healthcare, although access to healthcare is a very important issue that we pay attention to as well. We know that many of these drivers stem from historic oppression and exclusion, including poverty and racism. As such, we know that it's essential that every step we take in our strategies and in setting our priorities and our target populations, that our work always seek to create health equity by providing fair opportunities for those for whom health is furthest out of reach. And in the case of Colorado, again, that includes many Latino families. So what are we doing about it? And how are we approaching this? So we do our work through various levers, one of which, of course, is grant making. We also have policy and advocacy work that we do, also learning and evaluation, and recently much more capacity building. We also have specific focus areas and priorities that we have been very intentional in developing, and many of these priorities have children and youth, particularly Latino children and youth, and youth of color as the target groups that we really seek to serve. So what are some of these? Within within the Maintain Healthy Bodies focus area for the foundation, we have a priority that really emphasizes investments in helping build the infrastructure and the programming in communities of color so that children can be more physically active, so that children can really move their bodies more. We know that this is a big issue for our communities where rates of obesity are much higher than we'd like them to be. Also, in maintaining healthy bodies, we make strategic investments in communities that serve large Latino populations to invest in school-based health centers to create that under one roof access to comprehensive primary care that so many of our communities lack, and to create the convenience, if you will, for children to have both their physical and behavioral health needs met within the school system. Other things that we do related to nurturing healthy minds is we make investments in early childhood social emotional development, and we are recently very, very interested in increasing teen and young adult resiliency so that we can really help them build the healthy coping skills and the tools that they're gonna need to really handle the many challenges that life throws at them, and many more, especially now. In addition to that, in our work related to strengthening community health, we are focused on much more upstream approaches to health, so things like making sure that people have access to healthy food, and to reduce the number of families in Colorado that go hungry on any given day. We're also going to be making investments in affordable housing to make sure that the number of families who spend more than 30% of their income on housing, which has many downstream negative health effects, can actually be reduced so that they can afford to live in an affordable, safe place. This is particularly of interest in the Denver metro area, but it's also becoming a huge problem in rural Colorado, so we will be addressing those issues. And then lastly, in our work to really champion health equity, we're making our investments in advocacy and capacity building to make sure that individuals, organizations, and networks are equipped with the tools and knowledge and capacity necessary to really address health inequities and bring those solutions to bear for their communities. So those are just some of the things that we're working on in a broad, big picture perspective, and I'll be talking a little bit about some specific wins that we've had a little bit later on.
Thank you very much. Jorge, we heard from Maribel the different strategies and ways of attacking a big issue, health and well-being in Colorado in place. Your foundation plays this unique role of direct services, and particularly the work you're doing is foster youth, which is critical and maybe doesn't get a ton of attention. So within that frame of this, the larger issues, the impact of our Latino community, youth and families, can you speak a little bit to your work and particularly the focus on Latinos in that and the importance of direct services?
Sure, thank you, Gabby. Thank you also for the introduction. And so as Gabby mentioned, she was introducing me. So our foundation, KC Family Programs, we are dedicated to the improvement of the child welfare system. So those kids who are at risk of being abused or neglected, or who enter the foster care system for child protection reasons, that is our population. We have been doing this work for more than 50 years. We have three major areas of focus. As Gabby mentioned, direct services is a significant portion of our work. We have 9 offices where we do this work of serving directly. As an operating foundation, we do this direct work in serving kids and families, mostly in the Western United States. We also have in this commitment to systems improvement and the child welfare systems improvement and the related systems that impact them. We have presence in all states and territories of Puerto Rico and the Virgin Islands, where we enter into agreements with those agencies to provide technical assistance, consultation, et cetera, all aimed at this same goal of systems change. And finally, public policy is another important piece of the work. The education of policymakers who ultimately end up making or passing legislation that will benefit these children. Direct services is important to us in the sense that we are able to speak and give voice to the children and families that are directly impacted by the child protection system. So we bring quite a level of credibility when we speak about things like education to policymakers, where we talk to state governments and develop initiatives that will ultimately lead to systems change. So we think that the direct services, as Gabby mentioned, is a critical part because we have that direct contact with kids and families. And of course, Latino children are pretty much a part of our work. We are our direct service offices are in Texas, Arizona, California, Washington, and Idaho. So with and the predominant population, as you can imagine, is Latino children. Right? So we have that direct expertise and history of working with those populations. So I do want to bring some attention to a particular piece of legislation that from where we sit is really a breakthrough, is really precedent setting, and that is the Families First Prevention Act. that was just enacted, just passed February 9th, so it's very, very recent. And this builds on a really long period of time with a lot of work. It aligns with our public policy priority, which is finance reform. And what this legislation basically does is really change the framework of federal funding. For the longest time, the federal funding under the Title 4E of the Social Security Act allocated most of its funds to children in out-of-home care, those kids that had been removed and were in the child protection system and their families. Right? So what this legislation does is for the first time allow states to claim 4E funds for prevention efforts. So this is very significant because it really speaks to this notion that that we have been advancing for quite some time, that the child welfare system is much broader than just those kids in the, who've been removed and who are in out-of-home care. So we think there's a lot of opportunities to really engage in ways that are gonna be chart a different future for the kids and families who, you know, who are at risk of abuse and neglect for a variety of reasons. Many of them that you know well, and some of them I think is what Maribel was alluding to in her work on the education system. So we think that we have a tremendous opportunity to build, and really I think that the recognition that the federal government is now rethinking how to fund and how to think about the child welfare is much broader than just out of home care. So really thinking about what can we do from a prevention standpoint, keeping kids in their home safe and with giving access to resources. And primarily those resources would target mental health, substance abuse, which are many times the main reasons why kids come into care, because of mental health, substance abuse, right? But also in-home parenting skills programs, many of whom we know that there's a very good evidence-based programs out there in all these domains, but certainly those that support parents in their home, you know, with wraparound elements, could now be accessed at that prevention level under this legislation. So just wanted to point out the tremendous opportunities that we might have to chart a different course for kids and families.